Well, we're taking a look at section 3.5, looking at higher order derivatives. The first problem's a pretty good application problem here, talking about a position function gives you a position at time t is equal to negative 2.3t to the fourth plus 1.5t cubed plus 3.1t squared plus 3.2t plus 0.2. Now, based upon that position function, they're wanting you to evaluate the position of the ball's velocity, which is going to be the first derivative, the acceleration, second derivative, jerk, the third derivative, and snap, the fourth derivative, after a paddle ball starts its upward motion, round each answer to one decimal place. Okay, so whenever we go in there, we can just say, well, we had our original position function given, no problem with that. Now we know we can take the derivative of that with respect to time. Derivative of the first term gave me 4 times negative 2.3 was negative 9.2t cubed. Derivative of the second term, 1.5t cubed, gave me 4.5t squared. Next term gave me 6.2t. And of course, the derivative of 3.2t was just 3.2, and the derivative of any constant is 0. So the first step was get that velocity function. Then my first question was to evaluate the velocity at 1. And in fact, it wanted me to evaluate the velocity, the acceleration, the jerk, and the snap all at 1. So each of the successive derivatives evaluated at this same value of 1. When I evaluated the velocity function at 1, I got a 4.7. When I took the derivative of velocity to get to the acceleration function, I had negative 27.6t squared plus 9t, and of course the derivative of 6.2t gave me 6.2, derivative being constant, 0. When you plug a 1 into that expression, you get negative 12.4. For the jerk, so the change, you may have not heard that before, but the change in acceleration over the change in time, the instantaneous rate of change of acceleration, jerk. I always think of it as the force that makes you feel like you're going back into your seat. If you accelerate real quickly in a car, it's like, whoa. Well, it's because of the jerk. So in this case, the change in acceleration with respect to time is called jerk. And for this problem, the derivative would be 2 times negative 27.6 or negative 55.2t plus 9. You evaluate that at 1, we're going to get negative 46.2. And then the snap, which is the change in jerk with respect to time, so the instantaneous rate of change of jerk, that's just going to be the constant negative 55.2. And of course, there's no t value left to plug the 1 into. You just get your negative 55.2 constant value for when you evaluate the snap at 1. And you can see that that's precisely how the Achieve system wanted it for this problem. Now, when we look at the second one, quite a bit quicker problem. It just asked me to calculate the first, second, and third derivative of 3x to the seventh. Not really much work to show here. We would just say, well, we know it's just going to be the power rule. So your first derivative, you say 7 times 3 is 21, then decrease the exponent by 1, 21x to the sixth. Then you keep on doing that exact same process. Next step, I said, well, 21 times 6 is going to be 126. Drop the exponent, x to the fifth. Then I said, well, 5 times 126, I know 5 times 120 is 600, 5 times 6 is 30. So that's where I got my 630 from. And then drop the power, x to the fourth. All three of those go in as answers. Pretty quick and easy question. For the third one here, again, it's just asking me to take the derivative multiple times. This time it's the third derivative, again, of a polynomial function. So I know that the derivative is going to simplify each time. If I'm asked to take the third derivative of this function, I can say, well, derivative of x to the fourth is 4x cubed. Derivative of 3x cubed is 9x squared. Derivative of 14x is 14. Now that's my first derivative. Now, and remember, you can't get to your third derivative without finding the first and second derivative. So even though it didn't explicitly ask for the first and second derivative, You still had to find it. My second derivative, power rule on this. 3 times 4 is 12. I'll get x to the second. The second term, you'll have 2 times 9 minus 18, x to the first. And we know derivative of any constant is 0. To go from the second to third derivative, you'd say, well, 12 times 2 is 24, x to the first, using the power rule. Derivative of 18x is 18. I get my 24x minus 18. Pretty quick and easy final answer there. Similarly, number 4, pretty quick and easy. It's giving me a function y in terms of r, and it says, well, if y is 1/7 pi r to the 8th, let's find the first, second, and third derivative. It's asking for the second and third derivative. Again, you can't find those without finding the first derivative. So you'll see what I did here is I said, well, okay, if this is my original function, its first derivative, you're going to have to multiply the 8 down in front. It becomes 8/7 pi r to the 7th. Now, for the second derivative and for the first answer I'll have to input, you would say, well, what happens when you bring the 7 down? When you bring the 7 down and multiply, it's going to cancel out that denominator, and you'll have 8 pi r to the 6th. That's where this came from. And then for your final answer for the third derivative, y triple prime of r, you can say, well, that's just going to be 6 times 8 is 48 pi, and then you'll have r to the 5th. 48 pi r to the 5th. Final answer there. For the next question, this one's a bit more interesting because instead of just being a polynomial function where we just decrease the exponent by 1 and we get that nice whole number exponent each time, this one is going to be where we have fractional exponents. It's a rational function. So a lot more interesting to work with. So if I say I want to find the first, second, and third derivative here, this is what I would do. I'd say, well, okay, here's your original function. And I can say my first derivative, I would have 20 times 9/5. I know 20 divided by 5 is 4. 4 times 9 is 36. And then t to the 1 lower power, that gives me the 4/5 power. Now I'm taking the derivative of 6t to the 2/5. So I say, well, okay, it's going to be 6 times 2 is 12 divided by 5. I get my minus 12/5. And then t is raised to the 2/5 minus 1 power. That's where that negative 3/5 came from. Now I get this expression out. Myself, and I'm not sure if Achieve would accept this answer. It very well might. It doesn't say not to put it in negative exponents, but personally, I think it's bad format to have negative exponents in your final answer. So I went ahead and cleaned that up to this and said 12 divided by 5t to the positive 3/5. Now, when I take my second derivative, it's easier to look at this rather than this format. So I can say, okay, let's go from here to get to that second derivative. The first term, you'd have 36 times 4/5. Well, 36 times 4 is 144/5. And then I would have t to the 4/5 minus 1 power. That's where the negative 1/5 is coming from. My second term. Now, please notice why I'm changing this from a minus to a positive. You have a minus 12/5 times a negative 3/5. That's going to give me a positive 36/25 when I multiply those. And then my t is going to be to the negative 3/5 minus 1 power. That gave me negative 8/5. When I rewrite these in terms of positive exponents, I'll have 144/5 t to the 1/5 and plus 36/25 t to the 8/5 for the second term. Now, when I take the third derivative, again, it's easier to look at this unsimplified format. And I'll say, okay, power rule. 144/5 times -1/5. That gives me -144/25. And then I'll have t to the -6/5. That's -1/5 minus 1 power for the t to the -6/5 power. For my second term here, you would have, -8 times positive 36, that's minus 288/5 times 25, 125. So minus 288/125, t raised to the -8/5 minus 1 power, that gave me -13/5. So using my power rule gave me this for my third derivative. Again, I would prefer it cleaned up. Move this t to the denominator as t to the 6/5. This t to the denominator is t to the 13/5. And you'll see the answer that I entered in on Achieve just like that. Looks a little hectic, but no problem. Achieve accepts it just fine. For number 6 here, this one's quite a bit easier. We have y is a function of z, and it's equal to z minus 1 over z. The only thing that you need to do to make this problem easy to do is to remember that that second term of z is the same thing as z to the negative 1 power. So as long as you do that, this problem's easy. And you can say, okay, let's do that then. Derivative of the first term, derivative of z with respect to z, 1. You just say the 1 came down in front, then you have z to the 0. That's the same thing as 1. Power rule, derivative on the second term, please remember it was being subtracted, minus z to the negative 1. So when that negative 1 comes down in front, that's going to make that plus 1 z to the negative 2. So I have 1 plus z to the negative 2. That's better written as 1 plus 1 over z squared. That would be my first derivative, but they're asking for the second and third derivative. So I can say, okay, y double prime of z. We know derivative of any constant is 0, so that drops out. Derivative of this second term, negative 2 came down in front, then z to the negative 2 minus 1 power, z to the negative 3. I have negative 2 over z cubed as a simplified answer. Now when I take the third derivative, I would rather look at this unsimplified version and say negative 3 times negative 2 is positive 6, and then z to the negative 3 minus 1 power, z to the negative 4th. Better written as 6 over z to the positive 4th. And you can see my two answers there, no problem. For the next one here, we're asked for the second and third derivative of y of theta. Now, the thing that makes this problem more interesting than the ones preceding it is I'm going to have to use the product rule. So automatically, this one's better. And I can say, well, okay, no problem. I'm asked for the second and third derivative. I go ahead and find the first derivative because, of course, we have to. So first derivative, I'll say, since it's a product, I use the product rule and take the derivative of the first term, derivative of theta squared with respect to theta would be 2 theta to the first. You're just bringing that power down in front, dropping the power 1. So derivative of the first times the second plus the first theta squared times the derivative of the second. Well, the derivative with respect to theta, you'd say, well, that's a constant, so its derivative is 0. Derivative of this term, the 1 comes down, multiplies the 7, then you'd have theta to the 0. That's just 7 times theta to the 0, which is just the same thing as 7. So you'd say, okay, derivative of the first times the second plus the first times the derivative of the second. When I simplify this, I distribute the 2 theta through the first group. I get 14 theta squared plus 14 theta plus 7 theta squared. Now I'll go ahead and collect like terms to 21 theta squared plus 14 theta. Now, I had to use the product rule to find the first derivative, but after that, it's really easy to take the derivative. I can just say, well, what's the second derivative? Power rule, 42 theta to the first plus 14. What's the third derivative? 42. And you can see that that's precisely what Achieve wanted for this problem. Now for number 8, it gives me a quotient. And you could use the quotient rule. I opted not to here. Look what I did instead. I simplified algebraically rather than having to use the quotient rule. So I knew it's wanting the second and third derivative. I went ahead and found my first derivative by saying, well, if I have 3x minus 4 divided by x, that x in the denominator distributes into each term in my numerator. So it's 3x over x minus 4 over x. 3x over x is going to simplify to just be 3. And I know minus 4 over x could be more easily written as minus 4x to the negative 1. Now, I say more easily written because now I can just use the power rule on that. So when I take the derivative of any constant, 0. derivative of minus 4x to the negative 1, that's going to be plus 4x to the negative 2. That's where that came from. I have my first derivative done. I went ahead and rewrote it in a nicer format. Now, for the second and third derivative, I look at my unsimplified form and I can say, okay, my second derivative is going to be negative 8x to the negative 3 using the power rule. And it's better written as negative 8 over x cubed. For the third derivative, I would say, well, power rule again. Negative 8 times negative 3 is going to be a positive 24. Drop the exponent down 1, negative 4th power. So I have 24x to the negative 4, better written as 24 over x to the 4th. And I can see that that's the answers that Achieve wanted there. For the next question here, number 9, and it's by far the best of these. Woo! I love it. When we look at this one, we're asked for the first, second, and third derivative of x to the 7th e to the 4x. Okay, so I said I love it, but part of me doesn't love it because it's expecting you to use a rule that has not been introduced in our book yet. You might recall it was like the very last question, I believe, in the Achieve assignment for section 3.2, where it had us take the derivative of an exponential function that had an exponent other than x. It was like derivative of e to the 9x, and we had to put e to the 9x times 9. And I said, they're unfortunately forcing us to use the chain rule before it's being introduced. They're doing the same thing in this problem. So it's wanting us to calculate the first, second, and third derivative of y of x is equal to x to the 7th times e to the 4x. Okay, so I know it's a product, x to the 7th times e to the 4x. So I'm going to have to use the product rule. The product rule says that the derivative is going to be derivative of the first term, derivative of x to the 7th, 7x to the 6th. Derivative of the first times the second plus the first now times the derivative of the second. And I need you to remember, the derivative of any exponential function is that exponential function times the derivative of its exponent. You said, well, derivative of 4x is 4. So derivative of e to the 4x is e to the 4x times 4. Now, I have my derivative taken. I went ahead and simplified that. I think it's going to be easier for you to do multiple derivatives if you'll keep your answer factored. So when I looked at this first term and this second term, I said, well, both terms have a factor of e to the 4x. They also have a factor of x to the 6th. So I factored out x to the 6th, e to the 4x here. And when I did that, in the first term, if you factor out x to the 6th, e to the 4x, you have a 7 left over. If you factor out and x to the 6th and an e to the 4x in the second term, you're going to have an x and a 4 or 4x left over. So this is my fully factored final fantastic format for my first derivative, and you can see that's what I entered in here on Achieve for that answer. Now to get to my second derivative, I have to understand that now it's a three-term product rule. I have a differentiable function times a differentiable function times a differentiable function. How do I take the derivative? One term at a time. So the first one's going to be derivative of x to the 6th times the other two, plus the derivative of e to the 4x times the other two, plus the derivative of 7 plus 4x times the other two. That's what I'm doing in this step right here. Derivative of x to the 6th, 6x to the 5th, times the e to the 4x, times the group 7 plus 4x. Now, plus x to the 6th times the derivative of the 2nd, e to the 4x times 4 times the 3rd, plus the first term, x to the 6th times the 2nd, e to the 4x, now times the derivative of the 3rd term. Well, the derivative of the 3rd term is just the derivative of 4x, which is 4. So now I've got my second derivative, and you could put that as your answer. I wanted to go ahead and clean up that answer, especially since I knew I needed to take the derivative again. And so I went ahead and distributed out a 7 through this group, I distributed this term times 7 to get my 42x to the 5th, e to the 4x, Then I multiplied 4x by this to get 24x to the sixth e to the 4x. And then I multiplied this 7 by these two terms. I said, well, that's going to give me 28x to the sixth e to the 4x. That's where that term comes from. And then I multiplied the 4x by these two terms to get 16x to the seventh e to the 4x right there. And then my last term is just going to be plus 4x to the sixth e to the 4x. At that point, I said, well, okay, I know out of all of these terms, and several of them are like terms, I have 3x to the sixth term. So yes, those are going to gather. But before I worry about gathering those, I could see I could pull out a common factor of all of these coefficients have a common factor of 2. And then I at least have an x to the sixth, and sorry, x to the fifth in all of the terms. And all of the terms have an e to the 4x. So I factored out my greatest common factor. When I did that, this first term, 42 divided by 2, is going to leave me a 21. Everything else cancels. Now, my x to the sixth terms, I had 3 of them. I went ahead and added them. 24 plus 28, it's going to give me 52. Plus 4 would give me 56. 56 divided by 2 leaves me 28. And now out of that term, I'm canceling out the x to the fifth. So I have 28x. And of course, the e to the x canceled out because it's factored. So I have 21 plus 28x. Now the other term, after I factor out the common factor out of this, I'll have left over 8x to the second, because x to the fifth divides into x to the seventh, x squared times. So here's my nice polynomial left over after I factor that out, and I have my fully factored fantastic format of my final answer for the second derivative. Now, you didn't have to factor, but the alternative, if you didn't factor that, is when you took the derivative a third time, you would have to do 3 separate three-term product rule proofs in order to take the derivative. So while factoring that algebraically took a bit of time, it saved us a quite a bit amount of time now, because when we take our derivative again, we'll just say, well, okay, now how do we take the derivative of this group times this group? Well, I understand that my first term is 2x to the fifth, that's one function of x, times e to the 4x, that's another function of x, times this quadratic. So it's still one three-term product rule proof, where I say, okay, how do I take the derivative? It's the derivative of the first term, which is going to be 10x to the fourth times the second times the third, plus the first term, 2x to the fifth, times the derivative of the second term. Derivative of e to the 4x is e to the 4x times 4 times the third term, plus the first term times the second term, now times the derivative of the third term. And I can say, well, the derivative of this quadratic is just going to be 28 plus 16x. That's where that came from. And then there's no need to simplify this out, because I don't need to take the derivative anymore. The third derivative was the final answer we needed. So you can see I just typed that in precisely like that. I didn't worry about distributing and simplifying, although you could if you wanted to. It just wasn't required. I thought I did enough of that in the second derivative step, so I didn't want to take more time and do that for the third derivative. But that third derivative, perfectly fine in that format. Now, I'll go ahead and take a break here in the video, and I'll do another video with problems 10 through 16 in this section. And again, as always, please let me know if you have any questions. This question number 9 is a really cool problem. Make sure you understand it.